Good afternoon, everyone. And in fact, I will not take more than 10-15 minutes because I know I am between you and your lunch. So anyway, the topic was brick, clicks, and beyond. So there's something beyond which I will decide more on. Brick and click, we have discussed a lot. You know, when this subject came to me for brick versus click, I just recalled, and I'm sitting in a Hollywood station, that's Bollywood station today in Mumbai. So I recalled a movie where, you know, a hero is already stable in the college and a beautiful girl comes in, she wants to take his place, and then there's a competition. Finally, they both realize we are necessarily competing, we have a common goal, let's leverage each other's strengths. And then they propose each other to marry and take it forward. So I'll take my first slide and take a clue from this. This is exactly the article which had got published on 11th of April in ET. It says that, you know, Mr. Shadi Karoge. It was that on this, your online channel trying to woo offline channel. The reason is because there are many things which are common, which they have now realized that we can leverage it. And you know, both the channels have few strengths around them. At the end of the day, consumer remains the same. Like, for example, you know, the online is able to bring forward diverse consumer base, larger consumer access. Right? If there's a brick and the online you know, merger, then it's a possibility of revenue sharing and cost sharing, etc. Digital savvy, demanding customers are something which are already there on the online. So take it forward, and this is a brief, very brief agenda if you talk about it's a brick and click, market insights, and then what is beyond. I'll go back and see, look, when we started discussion 4, 5, or 6 years back, it was that who will survive. Today also one of the questions was that who will survive, brick versus click. Actually it was never brick versus click from the day one. Today, if I apply a Michael Porter model, we see that there are four or five forces which are bringing them together, which are compelling the brick to move along with the online or online with the brick. Like for example, new entrant, there's a supplier compulsion, there's a compulsion from the competition, there's a compulsion from the consumer, and there's a compulsion from the substitutes available. So these compulsions are basically forcing the bricks to move towards online and online towards bricks. If I go next, you know, the live examples, Walmart. I had thrown an example in my panel discussion also, which is moving from, which has moved from brick to online, and they're seeing the success. Starbucks, which was traditionally completely brick and mortar, they have moved online. You can put your coffee requirement on an app and you will get it once you go there. IKEA is coming to India. They have a complete brick and mortar structure. They're coming completely on online India also. Similarly, if you look into Indian companies, Domino's, 70% of the total sale in Domino's is through online. Though they have a complete brick and mortar structure. Croma, they're doing a huge amount of business through online. In fact, Croma is moving aggressively to improve their online customer journey to fit into their offline structure. Air India, Aditya Birla, Trading.com, that's also the clear reflection that brick is moving towards online because they see the strengths there. Now, if I go back and see on the other side, that is clicks moving to brick and mortar, Amazon. They're putting up the stores. Bonobos, the complete trouser making company, they're putting up the stores. MI, which had launched the mobile phones of the premium quality like OnePlus 2 or OnePlus 1 only on Amazon. They moved into Flipkart also. Now they're putting up the stores. Brick and mortar. Right. Similarly, Indian company, Landstar, it was purely online. Now they, you have your customer experience offline brick and mortar also. So they're seeing the reasons. So they're not doing, none of these companies are doing to copy someone. There is a reason. there's an analysis, there's a lot of strategic thinking which has gone and which clearly reflects that there is no competition. For a consumer at the end of the day, if I go next, even Paperfry is another example, if I go next, you will see that there are strengths of each. Now, a lot of strengths are there, but there's one major strength which probably is not mentioned here, that brick and mortar traditionally has been giving a factor of loyalty and stickiness better than the click. Your stickiness to horizontal like Flipkart, Amazon or any other will be very low in comparison to the stores you regularly go. You check yourself. You go to Big Bazaar, you go very regularly. Even if you don't buy anything, but you go at least there, see something, then maybe you pick up something. The reason is because there is a human factor which attracts you towards a loyalty. And that's the reason I was saying that the horizontal online companies have not been able to really create that stickiness. They have not been able to come out with a model within online that creates a loyalty. For example, me, I have been buying Flipkart stuff from the last 4 or 5 years regularly, in fact, complete my family members. As a loyalty, as I feel that loyalty, what have they done for me? Except throwing few pop-ups and emails. Nothing. The price discount is democratic. Even I buy or you buy, everything price is same. Customer experience is democratic. You buy the same supply chain, I get the same supply chain, so what? So where is the loyalty part? And how do you expect then a customer to have a stickiness with the online? Whereas brick and mortar brings that factor of or that strength. Even if I go to a shop, for example, I was there, one of the very large retail shop, and we had been going regularly. I went for an important purchase, and the purchase had gone to 20,000-25,000. And unfortunately, that day it was raining, so my credit card did not work. Can you believe the store guy said, sir, kal le lenge, koi baat nahi. That's a loyalty. What was there? We could have said, Mr. Paisa to pay, like any online shop. Can you get online material without that? So that's a strength of brick and mortar which online guys are realizing now, which stickiness was never there. There are other strengths also. There are some weaknesses also from both the sides. But that's a very important point which brick and mortar brings on table. Okay. So before we go that which will exist or why will it exist, let's see some market insights. Total retail market is of $110 billion. Out of that, your 900 is downward is completely unorganized. You don't get any bills. You go to local shop. You buy it, whatever you do. 900. You have only 190. Roundabout 190 billion dollar organized business. That's the modern rate. And out of 190, your e-retail is only 46 peanuts. So how can it be a competition? How can somebody eat the other? Impossible. Forget about the next 5 years. I am talking about 2020. Forget about 2020, even in 2025. So the common goal for each, whether it's online or modern trade, is to take away the share from traditional. Get that guy from traditional to modern trade or online by any means. That's a common goal. How to break the web of that kirana wala whose turnover is say 1 lakh to 5 lakhs per week, not more than that. And he's making 20% flat on that. How to break that? That's the common goal for both of them. So there is no competition per se that I can say very confidently standing here, and both will survive provided both help each other. Okay, so when we say that there is no, you know, competition with brick and click, etc., there has to be some optimal business model also. That's a particular thing which is very, very important, that how do you create that optimal business model which can leverage the stress sense of each other, whether they are connected or they are aligned, they have alliances or they have their own offshoots, is a separate thing. Like Walmart has its own offshoot, but that's fine. Whereas if you talk about some UK stores or US stores, they have alliances with Alibaba.com. So US retail, they're not able to access China because of cost, etc. So they have alliances with Alibaba.com. I will showcase that in the next couple of slides. This is another market insight. The customer. You can't control the customer. There are so many channels to see. Look, he can discover from 9 different channels about your product. He can search from 9 different product, you know, types of channels. He can research, he can compare, he can decide, and he can purchase from any of these 9. So 9 into 9, 81 permutation combinations are already existing with a consumer. How can somebody say that online will eat away the retail? Brick and mortar retail. There are already 81 combinations existing. And I'm not putting beyond here. Beyond is another. So, we believe as KPMG that there's no point in even discussing brick versus click. That's absolutely no point. It should be that how brick and click and beyond can work together. Right? When we talk about brick and click, the biggest enabler to marry them is digital intervention. Lenskart is using it. That's advanced personalization. Aditya Birla Group, I was told, in fact, we had been associated with them, that they are also working on virtual mirror. The virtual mirror, what it does is that you go to your trial room, you wear your shirt or a trouser. If you like it, you, in front of the mirror itself, digitally put it in your cart and pay it there so it becomes yours. Then, if you want to try other things, it gives you an option of that what color of trousers will match that shirt. That's a virtual mirror. That's a level of digital experience is being created in the stores. So, digital is not about only e-commerce. It's also about your customer experience. Somebody had asked also like what is happening in India around the digital interventions in the store, how do you increase the customer experience, etc. So these are the levels of it. Even on online lenskart.com, that's providing you some level of personalization. Asian Paints have started getting the personalization. Many other organizations, like for example, some of the car manufacturers, high-end car manufacturers, they have started providing you the 3D view of the personalization of the cars. So those things have started happening in India also. So that's one of the big levers which is going to marry the online with brick. The second is 3D printing. A great game changer, especially for FMCG market, for CDIT market. 3D printing will help you to figure out what do you actually want. Like for example, shoes, I'll say the shoe size. You go to any shop, probably down the line 3 years, you put up your foot in front of the particular 3D printer which will have 30 odd cameras, they will immediately get you the a model or a frame or a mold of your shoe, and then you decide it on the design, and within 3 days you will get the final product. No need of having a separate R&D workshops, you will have it on the store itself. So that's another level of digital intervention which is there. Gamification. Today, standing here, I am actually playing a game. Can you imagine? I'm in a contest. I'm wearing this Fitbit Surge. We had a contest yesterday night with some unknown communities, because there are so many guys who are connected with me on Fitbit, this community, where we had a competition that by this weekend we have 20,000 steps and 5 kilometer running. So I am counting that how many times I am moving out so that at the end of Sunday I am able to come, win that and get at least some virtual medal. That's again a digitization. And that's creating the communities for the gamification. So what is happening, somebody asked about the digital, you know, customer engagement. This is also customer engagement. Fitbit is engaging me. They're creating the communities, they're understanding the behavior, they're engaging me. Same with Nike. They engage me through this gamification process, which is again a digital intervention. Right? Like workforce level management. another very important thing, if you want to bring online and brick and mortar together, you have to enable your workforce with right equipment in hand. Like for example, iPads or some other screens enabled. Where the person, I'll give you a very simple example. I had got a new house and I got in touch with the Philips guy to get the complete lighting LED for my house. The Philips engineer came from Philips, he bought an iPad. He took the dimensions, basic dimensions, where do I need the lights, and then he had put it in the system of on his iPad. And then he gave me the complete demo that what lights will look like actually in my house. I did not see any other, I didn't even go to any other competition. I was so impressed. Each and every corner of my house was covered through his iPad to figure it out, okay, for the steady light, this should be the intensity of the light. For the kitchen entry, this much. For the hall, this much. Okay, if you have a veranda in the evening time, this should be the light. This should be the focus, whether it should be COB or it should be the direct light. Everything with the detailed demo. That's a digital intervention. Now, once I have taken the product, now if I want to repeat it, I will not go to the store. I have the specification, I put it online. So it's a merger of online and offline. Right. Then, as I said, digital physical world is blurring. Innovation is, a lot of innovation is going. APIs, open source APIs are coming in, which are also bringing digital, online, and offline model together. Invisible security like fingerprints, etc., which is improving the security aspects. A hyper-local reach is another digital intervention. Digital partnership, I was talking about your example of US, it's a US retail. They have tied up with Alibaba. Exclusive tie-up. So now they are serving China not with their any store but through Alibaba.com. So there is no question of saying that brick will work separately or click will work separately. That wall is no more existing. Right. Okay, so once you understand the market insight, let's understand how will your modern stores or the stores which have a click and brick pairing, how will they look like? Look, the stores will have a lot of sensors. They will have beacon technologies. For example, I'll take it to the next slide. It's a simple slide. It says, okay, there's an end of season sale in one of your hyper stores. I get it through Facebook, right? I place an order on that. I see the catalog. I place an order on that. I have an app of that. I put up a timing where I'll be going. The moment I say this time I'll be going, I get a message from them that, okay, at this particular point of time, at your locality, these many cabs are available. So so when you say this online-offline marriage, it's not only between the online-offline store guys, but also with your other guys, like logistics guys. Uber is talking with multiple hyper-stores where they're saying, you share the data with us, when the guy is coming to you, we'll at least send them details that my car is available at the end of, at the, doorsteps. Would you like to go along with me? So you have a vehicle also available now, made available by the source. At the moment you enter the source, there's a technology called beacon technology, which reads your app. And it's on the source. The moment you enter, they get the information, okay, the Rajdhani has entered the store, his material is ready. They make sure that you get the material within the few minutes. So that's a customer journey. So if I go back, your store will primarily, So your store will have a lot of sensors, interventions from the beacon technologies, mobile interfaces, which will help the consumer to track you, which will help you to close your deal faster with a better experience. This is just an illustrative one. A lot of stores have started doing it in small pieces like this. This I already discussed. So finally, what is happening is today, most of the stores are individually working. If they go online as a marketplace, they're independent because their strategy, pricing strategies are different for online or offline. They are moving towards some sort of interconnected. But finally, if you talk about the marriage between the brick and click, it will be completely integrated. So one thing is that there is not any price differentiation. If you talk about omni-channel experience, then there is no price differentiation. Okay, if you buy it online, you get 10 rupees discount. If you buy offline, you don't get a discount or something like that. You don't feel a difference. You only feel the convenience at the end of the day in omni-channel. It's your choice whether you would like to have click or brick. Maybe. We are working, as of now, I'm working with the retail stores where we are saying that we will have a mechanism where if I'm moving out of my office and I have a detail of what I need all, I'll put it in the system and through the GPS, they track my route and then they SMS me, okay, your material is at this particular red light, they have a storage wallet, etc. You put up the password on the storage and collect the material and move out. Which suits them logistically because it's convenient to supply within the radius of 2 kilometers and it is on my way to my home. Metros, we are going to capitalize on metros, kiosks on metros, to place an order and move forward. By the time you are at home, your material is also at home. You don't need any iPads or apps or your Wi-Fi or signals there. Right. So that way we are trying to integrate it. Okay. If we talk about beyond. We had been talking about only on online and brick. There is a huge amount of possibility of intervention of virtual wall. There is a pilot also going on. Where you don't have any inventory. You don't have any inventory, you just have a virtual wall. You go there, you have QCRs, barcode scanning, put it in your cart, put it, pay it through your Paytm wallet or whatever wallet you are using, the material will be supplied to your destination. It's a big time game changer. Then the pop-up shows. If you see in the picture itself, it's a container actually, where it moves around. It has the displayable items only. It doesn't supply from there. It displays the items. You can place the order. There are kiosks within that particular pop shop, and they keep moving from society to society, from place to place, and you place your order. And they will supply it. But we can touch and feel. That's another model. Then collect and pick and collect centers. This is something which we are already working with a couple of retail guys. Then this Uber can collect our corner store. They are trying to come up very heavily on the logistics front for your supply of material. So this is something which is beyond your thinking, which will also come into. Now tomorrow we cannot say that is it going to stay or is it going to eat away my market. No, there is a huge market. There is a tendency of small amount of cannibalization, no doubt about it. But in a long run, both will sustain if they want to sustain. The point is if they want to sustain, that's it. If they don't want to sustain, then there are 1,000 ways to kill yourself. So, I think this is what I had for you. It's very short, what I thought I'll share with you. We are doing a lot of work with retail companies to improve on their efficiencies, etc. But the major chunk is on the digital side, digital interventions to improve their in-house efficiency, and also we are working a lot on the, which I was talking about in the panel also, on the persona and personal, categorization. We do the customer journey mapping, persona journey mapping, and then set the digital and the processes accordingly so that you as an individual are treated as an individual, not as a segment. And that's what retail is moving towards. Thank you very much. Thank you. Any questions? I would like to, if you like. At the end of the day, it enhances the customer experience. It enhances the customer. Yes. In fact, they come out to be much more cost effective also. Right. Secondly, it enhances your customer experience and brings in the convenience part. We are working with a couple of organizations in India also as a pilot. Yeah, please. Yeah, sure.
Yeah, Sheldon Martin from Reliance Retail. You made a statement saying that online, offline, there is no price differential. There's no need to differentiate on price. While I buy that when you're talking about value of grocery business, where you know the frequency of purchase is high, involvement tends to be low, like Radha was talking about. I think that you know it's a different beast when you're talking durables, you're talking lifestyle. And the case in point is if you look at a retailer like Reliance Digital, which, and I'm just making an example here, if in case you're present brick and mortar, where you have a 2-3% logistics cost, manpower, power, you know, rent, whatever, again, Radha was talking about, vis-a-vis a Flipkart or Reliance Digital Direct, or an online player, who, even from a consumer standpoint, would have certain cost advantages in terms of not having these overheads. Would I not want to be passing on some advantage? I'm not saying about being ridiculous, where we pass on investor money to the consumer. I'm not talking about that paradigm which existed 3 years ago. I'm saying that in, you know, when you're talking basic P&L affordability, would I not pass on that differential and be at par with the Flipkart who has those advantages? Or would I maintain the same price and therefore lose share or opportunity?
Okay, great. So, the pricing strategy is a big time discussion which probably will not end here, but there are two things which you need to understand from consumer perspective, and you are also one of the customers, right, for anything you buy. The moment you see the difference that online, when you bought it offline, of X price, and later on you realize that online it was from the same retailer, was cheaper by 2% if you cheated, and that's a disaster for omnichannel experience. When you talk about omnichannel experience, you need to be very, very clear in your pricing strategy, in your other, you know, strategies related to the customer behavior, that in no place you should feel disconnected. It will not survive. It will not survive at all as a consumer, as a businessman, or as a business itself. If you don't have a connection between the two, if you say, okay, one is this digital, which is giving a facility of online order but collection at the stores, and I'm maintaining the same price. And if you have another entity, maybe Reliance X, where you say, okay, you buy online only, I don't have an offline store and I will only supply, there could be some price differentiation. But if within the same entity, it will be disaster. Just look at yourself only. For example, if it's a Croma, if Croma says, okay, if you buy, place an order online, 20% discount, but if you come to my own shop, you'll be penalized, how can Croma survive? Or anybody else? Can somebody survive like that?
So I know that there's no solution. Like you said, the price will go on.
It's not a matter of solution. See, look, again, I'm saying, at the end of the day, if you're talking about passing down the benefits, pass down the benefit in the form of customer experience. That's going to create the stickiness, not the price.
It's challenging because when you're talking about...
Yeah, it's challenging. It is a challenging. Either you end up becoming Mr. Biani or you end up becoming bankrupt. It's a challenging, no doubt about it.
Yeah, so but whatever you're saying, whatever you suggested in terms of maintaining the same price, in a world where you have Google spiders and you have crawlers which are mapping a Croma or a Reliance Digital, vis-a-vis a Flipkart. So if I'm looking for a durable which is a one-ton AC, I go and I type in a simple product spec like a Voltas 1-ton AC or a Carrier 1-ton AC, and I'm going to have prices mapped of a Flipkart vis-a-vis a Croma vis-a-vis a Reliance Digital. That is a sort of challenge that we need to be addressed.
See, again, I'll say that is a very big challenge, that there is a price discounting happening in one. You know, it's again with a brick and mortar also. You go to any brick and mortar shop, for the same brand, Surf Axel, one brick and mortar retailer is selling at 350 rupees kg, the other guy is selling at 415 rupees. Because this price is 415, the other guy sells at 350 because he is ready to take the brand. You can't change that environment, to be honest. But as an omnichannel, if it is the same cycle getting into it, the same brick and mortar getting into online, then it is always advisable to make sure that the customer doesn't feel cheated. That tomorrow, in case he goes online and sees, okay, my price was much lower if I had gone online for the same store, that's a cheating. That's not a sustainable model. Then you lose the cost. Then the customer acquisition cost is too high as of now. You won't be able to retain customer. You will simply be becoming a problem for the complete customer base.
Anyway, thanks.
A lot of being said about the requirement of a regulatory body like IRDA for e-commerce sector. What are your views on that aspect?
So there are certain things which are beyond the capacity of an individual's, right? Like for example, government regulations. Today there's a 100% FDI, I agree, but again there are rules like you cannot have more than 25% from one particular vendor if you want to go online. So they are constraints when you make, and that's what where we play our role, that within that constraint, how do you create an optimal business model? And these constraints will keep shifting or moving. Tomorrow you may have a GST, third day you may have something else coming in. We need to create a business model living with that constraint. The constraints will never go away. They will keep moving. They will keep shifting. So we need to create a business model in such a way that's standardized and equally flexible enough to take the, take off that particular regulation, which is not that good for your industry.
One more thing I would like to ask for. We have missed that in the panel discussion as well. There's the reverse logistics or the returns which are happening in e-commerce, which is also actually leading to the bleeding of the profit margins.
Very true.
So any take on that, how this can be controlled?
Forget about me, Flipkart doesn't have it. I'll give you my experience. I bought a dustbin from Flipkart. It was a steel dustbin, just 900 rupees. It got returned 5 times. I met a Flipkart guy in one of the Gartner shows. I asked him, "Your boss, you survive कैसे करते हो?" He says, "कि मेरे को क्या होता है? Marketplace वाला देखेगा जिसने बेचना है, उसका product था वो देखेगा." So you get the answer. मेरे को क्या? Flipkart को नहीं पता वो कैसे करेंगे. उनको लगता है कि जिसने बेचा है वो देखेगा, उसने बेचा है वो देखेगा, उसका end मैं क्या करूँ? So yes, reverse logistics is a problem, but then the guys who are building the business model for themselves will have to look for the solution also. Right. Thank you very much, Nick. Thank you.
Thank you, Dadash. With this, we officially conclude the second edition of the Economic Times Retail Forum. Once again, on behalf of ETRetail, Microsoft, and KPMG, I want to thank each one of you for taking our time, and I hope there were some key learnings that you have taken from here. Look forward to your support in the future, and please join us for lunch outside. Thank you so much. Thank you.